the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. I welcome you as I would welcome Christ himself to what's happening Presbyterian this morning. We're glad you're here. And if you are new to us, please take a moment to sign our guest book in the back and fill out the pew pad at the end of each pew and help us to have the right contact information for you. Note the announcements here in the insert. We want to encourage those of you who have yet to volunteer to usher for a Sunday service. There are always spaces for you to serve in that capacity. The usher sign-up sheet is on the bulletin board as you go to coffee hour today. So I hope you pause and select a Sunday or more and serve in that way. Note the announcement about we rejoice in the rose. I think there's a rose on the community table. There is, in celebration of Melissa Marks and Melissa Marks Coates, Melissa and Brian's Lynn Rainer Coates, great grandson. Her son was born, and we're very happy for them. Note, next Sunday is World Communion. We will always make that. It's a highlight of our life together throughout the year, and we draw speakers from various parts of the world and various causes that will help us to understand some of the things that stand between us and being one world community. Jim Atwood is our speaker for next week. You don't want to miss him. He's engaging and a bright light and will be a wonderful worship leader. And we want to particularly include the youth and others in the conversations with him throughout the weekend. So plan next week. Come to worship. Stay for the brunch that follows. Come for the adult study. If you can't come for the brunch, 8:45. We'd love to have as many youth as possible at that event as well. He'll also be speaking at the Quad Library in the afternoon, and I hope he will make it a point to be part of it. That also underscores my invitation to the adult study. Each week, the adult study is taught. Very good. Creighton Berry did a wonderful job this morning, and I hope you will make time for several, if not all, of the adult studies throughout the fall. With the announcement about tricks and tours, we also lift up Reverend Richard. The family of Reverend Richard Plott. Dick Plott was the interim executive in this presbytery for several years, as well as pastored several churches. So he passed away last week, and his memorial service will be in October the 10th. I also want to recognize Angel Kalfayan. We're so glad you're back this morning, and you are a sight for sore eyes, so God bless you. We hate to see you go back to Illinois and then California, so we've decided to let the air out of your tires. That's my feeble attempt at humor. What it does communicate, and I hope you hear it that way, is our great love for you and gratitude for your participation. So you and Denise, you go with our love and goodwill. Let us worship God. Thank you. in the call to worship. Let us come to the Lord, all who are weary. Let us come to the Lord, all who are sad. Let us come to the Lord, all who are confused and have lost our way. Praise the Lord.
Help us to open our hearts and receive your forgiveness. Help us to open
as our life. We fall and then with God's help, we rise. We stub our toes and then with God's help, we heal. We fall and then we rise. We acknowledge our sins and then hold on to the amazing grace that infuses our worship. Friends, believe the good news of the gospel today. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Hallelujah. Amen. Some of you are already on your way. It's time for children's message this morning. Do you know anyone named Esther? Let's see if anybody in the congregation, do you know anyone named Esther? Look at everybody. Everybody knows someone named Esther. Esther was a remarkable, remarkable young lady. She was an exile, or she was someone who had been taken into a country not where her home was, and she lived there amongst all the other Israelite exiles. And one day she was selected to be the king's new queen because she was very pretty. And she was very smart. And she was very attractive in many ways. So Esther did something. She picked up on a plot or a plan by somebody who was very mean. His name was Haman. And Haman was plotting to get rid of all of the Israelites. Mean kind of guy. And so she said, I've got to do something to help save my people. So when the king said, Esther, I love you so much, I'll give you whatever you want, even up to one half of my kingdom. That's a lot. Half of a kingdom. Can you imagine somebody coming up to you and says, I like you so much, I'll give you half the United States. Kind of weird. Well, she thought to herself, and then she didn't take the first option, which would be up to half of the kingdom. She'd be a very powerful and influential woman for the rest of her life if she took that. What she did instead, she said, no, King Ahasuerus, I can't pronounce it. I hope I'll do a little better in the real sermon a little later, the adult sermon. Ahasuerus. She said, King Ahasuerus, I'd like you to do something better. There is a wicked plot to get rid of all the Israelites, all of the people of God, and I'd like you to save them. Who is King Ahasuerus was very angry. He said, who is the author of this plot? Haman. Haman, your assistant, Ahasuerus. Be done with that. You shall have your wish granted, and all your people will be free. Sometimes we have to make a decision based not only what's good for us and what we want, but what the world around us needs. And that's the story of Queen Esther. Well, anyway, we'll be talking about Queen Esther in the sermon today. And I hope you'll have a chance in your Bible to turn to Esther. It's right before Job in the order of things. And I hope you'll have a chance to learn and celebrate who she is and why she matters so much to anyone who's a person of faith. Let us pray. We thank you, Lord, for Esther. And we thank you for the scriptures and stories of our redemption. We thank you for people who made sacrifices on behalf of others. We ask that you would help us be generous in our commitment, lofty in our ambitions, and concerned and loving in all our relationships. Through Jesus Christ. Amen. Go slowly to your church school class. Go slowly. Thank you. friends, we turn to the Lord today and remember those in our prayer concerns. They're listed before you. I encourage you, as always, to take this list home and pray for these friends daily. The best gift you can offer, I believe, is your prayers of intercession, asking God to be present. Likewise, we now open the floor for your suggestions. Are there others who need to be in this list? Please feel free to add them at this time. If you have someone to suggest, Jeannie?
Chuck, most of us have been listening to Pope Francis, and he continually said to pray for me. I think maybe it would be good if you pray for all of the leaders of the Church Universal, our moderator, yourself. We don't have to go down the list, but we will pray for the Church leadership.
Thank you. Let us unite our hearts and minds in prayer. Let us pray. How can our hearts keep from singing, O God, for you have done marvelous things. You have raised us up from another night's rest, given us the air we breathe, the food we eat, the hopes we have. You have given us every good blessing that enables us to be faithful. We thank you, and we begin our prayer in gratitude. Gratitude for surrounding us with moments, times, songs of inspiration, your word, which is our light in darkness. We pray for the church today, and especially its leaders, for those who lift up the gospel, who read the words, that are also in their way they live their life, exhibit your word. Teach us the power of fervent prayer this morning, that whether we are healthy or sick, or whole or suffering, we might sing your praise and praise your name. We pray for the world and empower ordinary people to take risks for the sake of peace and justice. Help us to remember the poor, the vulnerable. God of abundant grace, hear our prayers today. Bless the good that we seek to do in your name, and help us to work together more effectively. Help us to find common cause with all who do your will. We pray for loved ones, especially those in distress. When danger or suffering prevails, show us the strength of your steadfast love, and that nothing at all can separate us from your love as it is revealed in Christ Jesus. Generous God, as you provide for us each day, nourish and strengthen us in faith and faithfulness, so that we may share your grace in a hungry world. Through Jesus Christ, the bread of life, the one who teaches us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. As we prepare to give our gifts this morning, I'd like to call on Stuart Wood to give us a minute for mission regarding this year's prop walk. Stuart?
What a world of trouble we live in. AIDS, malaria, tuberculosis. But hunger kills more than these combined every year. Malnutrition causes one-third of all childhood deaths before the age of five. There are 50 million Americans who live in food insecure households. And one in eight Americans get what we used to call food stamps. One solution that we can take part in is called Church World Services. It's a combination of 37 Protestant denominations that work together to try to eradicate hunger and help in times of disaster. What do? They provide food, as we would expect, plus they give communities the skills and tools they need to be ultimately able to feed themselves. 40 million people have been displaced by war and persecution, and that statistic is before this latest war of everybody fleeing Syria. 40 million plus, how many more now? 20 more? Church World Service provides essential services, but they also run a resettlement program to assist refugees who want to resettle here in the United States. They respond to emergencies worldwide with blankets and kits. And the part that I always like, and I want you to hear, is that only 4% of the money donated to them goes to running. 96%, 96 cents of every dollar goes actually for the literal support and not paying administrative salaries and things like that. In addition, whatever we give to them, 25% of it is given back to us to help our local missions. We have, for example, often helped the food pantry that's run by the local Roman Catholic Church. We do raise our money this way through what's called a crop walk, and we're doing one now, 3 weeks from now, on October 18th. You've been around here and you've seen this. I came to this church in 1984, and it had been here a long time at that time. We're having three walks again this year. The first one is just down to the duck pond and back. It's about a half a mile each way. And we encourage children of any age or anybody who has trouble walking longer distances or is pressed for time, you have met your commitment if you walk down to that duck pond and come back. The second walk is going to be over to, from here, over to St. Mark's Episcopal Church, and that's about a mile each way. And the third walk is going to be from here, over the bridge to Dune Road, down Dune Road, over the other bridge, back by St. Mark's, and back here. And that walk is about 6 miles. And I'm real pleased to be able to say that the new pastor at St. Mark's Episcopal Church, Father Ralph, is going to come with us, and he's going to walk the whole 6 miles. So I hope there will be lots of you who would think something like this is fun. And if you can't participate in that way, then you would be willing to donate for it. For the next 3 weeks, I'm going to be out at the coffee hour looking for people who want to walk to sign up, and then they will come around to you and recruit you to give them cash or write a check. And I just say in advance, we'd like the checks to come made out to West Hampton Presbyterian Church so that we can then just write one check to Church World Service. It's a very good place to help other people in the world and know that the money really goes to what it should be doing. Let us now give our gifts.
Thank you.
be at peace. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
The scripture for today, you can find in the Old Testament, Esther 7, 1 through 10, and then chapter 9, 20 through 23. There's been a lot of debate among scholars throughout history about whether or not Esther belongs in the Bible. Why? Because it's one of the books that God is not even mentioned here. Although I was taken by a comment from a scholar I was reading this week who said, "You really think God is not mentioned, but God is in the wings, like a director of an outstanding play, making God's influence known." Listen for the word of God from Esther 7, 1 through 10, and 9, 20 through 23. So the king and Haman went in to feast with Queen Esther. And on the second day, as they were drinking wine, the king said again to Esther, "What is your petition, Queen Esther? It shall be granted you. And what is your request? Even to the half of my kingdom, it will be fulfilled." Queen Esther answered, "If I have won your favor, O king, and if it pleases the king, let my life be given me, that is my petition, and the lives of my people, that is my request. We have been sold, I and my people, to be destroyed, to be killed, to be annihilated. If we had been sold merely as slaves, men and women, I would have held my peace. But no enemy can compensate for this damage to the king." Then King Ahasuerus said to Queen Esther, "Who is he, and where is he, who is presumed to do this?" Esther said, "A foe and enemy, this wicked Haman." Haman was terrified then, terrified before the king and the queen. And the king rose from the feast in wrath, and he went outside into the palace garden. But Haman stayed to beg his life from Queen Esther, for he saw that the king had determined to destroy him. When the king returned from the palace garden to the banquet hall, Haman had thrown himself on the couch where Esther was reclining, and the king said, "Will he even assault the queen in my presence, in my own house?" As the words left the mouth of the king, they covered Haman's face. Then Harbona, one of the eunuchs in attendance, said, "Look, the very gallows that Haman has prepared for Mordecai, whose word saved the king, stands at Haman's house, 50 cubits high." And the king said, "Hang him on that." So they hanged Haman on the gallows that he had prepared for Mordecai, and the anger of the king abated. And picking up in chapter 9, verse 20, Mordecai recorded these things and sent letters to all the Jews who were in all the provinces of King Ahasuerus, near and far, enjoining them that they should keep the 14th day of the month Adar, also the 15th day of the same month year by year, as the days on which the Jews gained relief from their enemies, and as the month that had been turned for them from sorrow into gladness, and from mourning into a holiday. That they should make them days of feasting and gladness, days for sending gifts of food to one another and presents to the poor. So the Jews adopted as a custom what they had begun to do, and Mordecai had as he had written to them. This is the word of the Lord. Let's pray. Let the words of my mouth and the meditations of each and every one of our hearts, let them be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. There's so much in this book of the Bible, that resembles a Shakespearean plot. Esther's story makes up the narrative for the Jewish festival of Purim, which is similar to our Halloween celebration. Think about it. Stay with me. You have a king with a large but impressionable ego. He's named Ahasuerus. loves to party. In fact, the book opens as he's giving a six-month banquet, all for the purpose of showing off his great wealth. Now, I predict he's very insecure if it takes 6 months to show off his great wealth. In fact, well, you have a setting. What would be modern-day Iran, but was then called the Persian Empire. You have an established queen, Vashti, who refused her king's command to go on display, or as we would say, be his trophy wife, at the celebration, the six-month celebration. He then dismissed her when she was disobedient, which says something right there. You have two Israelite exiles, Jewish exiles, Mordecai and Esther, cousins. Mordecai is an intuitive chap who saves the king from a planned mutiny by two of his Persian subjects. He also advances the cause of Esther, Mordecai does, by helping her enter the national beauty contest to determine Queen Vashti's successor. It gets even better. Read the book sometime. And Esther herself is beautiful. She is wise. She is also coy and sly. And then there is the nemesis, whose name is Haman. And if you ever attend a Purim ceremony, you will hear, whenever his name is read in the synagogue, that people will hiss and boo. He was a raging anti-Semite. He was a forerunner, if you will, of Adolf Hitler. Now, as the story unfolds, Mordecai and Esther keep their Israelite identity secret. Esther wins the beauty contest. The king, Ahasuerus, is so taken by her that he promises up to one half of his kingdom. It's hers if she wants it. He's smitten. Meanwhile, Haman has been plotting to kill all the Israelites in Persia. Yes, if you will, a forerunner to the Holocaust. Mordecai and Esther get wind of it, and soon this new queen is not only revealing her identity, she requests that King Ahasuerus save her people, a gift more preferable than one half of his kingdom. And not only does the king say yes, he demands to know who is behind this wicked plot. Mordecai and Esther chime in, and he finds out it's that wicked Haman, whom he dismisses outright and orders hanged. The book involves intrigue, not a little bit of seduction, fearless planning. Esther goes from exiled orphan from Israel to queen of the Persians. I don't think that was her career goal. That's not what she chose, but that's what she did. And in doing so, it turns out she is the savior of her people, employing a strategy no one would have ever imagined. So it goes. God's ways are not always our ways. A beautiful queen wins the trust and admiration of her king. She does so without identifying herself as a foreigner, an alien. Then by refusing to look out only for number one, she pleads the case of her people under threat. And she convinces the king to protect them rather than persecute them. What a turn of events. The story ends with Mordecai becoming the lead assistant and Esther remaining as the queen, the fairest in all of Persia. No, sisters and brothers, God's ways are not our ways. She could have employed other plans. She could have used that selfish slogan, I'm going to look out for number one, meaning herself. She could have kept quiet, refusing to risk her own security on behalf of her people. After all, she had it made. She could have up to one half of the kingdom. But she also had a king who was in love with her. Esther could have kept quiet and gone along in order to get along. That would maintain the status quo until the threats died down. Maybe Haman would soften his heart. Maybe he'd just go away. But he didn't. And she didn't. She had other ideas. She refused to look out solely for number one. She was part of something greater, a people, God's people, who had been persecuted long enough. She would not keep quiet as though she had no power to influence. She did have influence, and she used it. She did have power, and she used it for the greater good, for such a time as this. Melissa Flora Bixler, a Mennonite from Chapel Hill, North Carolina, recently wrote an article I was reading for Christian Century, where she explained that her church's practice of something I don't understand, and please wait till after the service to look it up on your handheld device. Z-E-U-G-N-I-S. It's a word which corresponds to our English word discernment. In a recent Sunday evening service, a member stands, or at a typical Sunday evening service for the Mennonites, a member will stand before the people and offer an invitation. He'll say, where, or she will say, where did you sense God's Spirit among us tonight? Melissa is quick to clarify this is not the occasion for discussing the finer points of the evening sermon or add one's opinions. And it's not a time for anything petty or contrived. It's instead a moment in time, a planned time for probing the question, what in the world is God up to in the world we live in? There's a certain solemnity to the practice of Zigness, solemnity. And often she says the answer comes in long, uncomfortable silences, and sometimes it's tearful, and some nights it doesn't come at all. Where did you sense God's Holy Spirit among you tonight? The accompanying conviction is that the Spirit speaks not just through individuals, but through a whole people, the gathered disciples, the church. And Melissa, a Mennonite Christian, confirms that she represents not just her own private self, but the souls of her sisters and brothers who are important. We are part of something larger than ourselves. And her strategy resembles the strategy of Queen Esther, whom God had chosen for such a time as this. A strategy which offers us wisdom. We find ourselves in situations which require our gifts, our blessings, our tactful action to make the world a better place. And yes, sometimes the destiny of a people, or a family, or a church, or a neighborhood is tied to what we do and how we speak up. Queen Esther, having won the beauty contest of the entire Persian Empire, having won the affection, the loyalty, the love of King Ahasuerus, how she must have gotten tired of saying that. Having won the love and loyalty of the king for such a time as this, she asks for the redemption of her people. I don't know, but you know, that God is calling you for such a time as right now. Calling you to employ your God-given gifts and skills, not only for your church, but for this world. God in Christ, who knows you by name and loves you more than you love yourself, is summoning you to take up a cause. Give of yourself. Employ the power at your disposal to advocate for your people. To climb out of your fears or worries and build a bridge where there was once a divide. I believe that. That God is calling you and me for such a time as today, the times of uncertainty and threat, to create a world of safety and peace. At this point in the week, everyone's still abuzz about the Pope's visit to New York. Everyone has a favorite story, a discovery, a learning. His address perhaps to the United Nations, or his mass at Madison Square Garden. I hope that will have a good omen on the New York Knicks this year. His visit to a school in East Harlem, where he was serenaded spontaneously. Did you see that part? A lot of spontaneity in the scripted visit. His visit to a Catholic charities office, which reflected his heart for the poor. His opening prayer service in St. Patrick's Cathedral, where he singled out religious women with the simple affirmation, "I love you." A stark contrast to others who had launched what seemed to be an inquisition into the orders of religious women in America. His disarming aura of unity wherever he went in the great city to our west. And it is a great city to be proud of. I was taken most of all by his visit and words at the 9/11 memorial. Did you notice it? Friday morning, he was surrounded by hundreds of leaders from the world's religions. It could have been a who's who of Huston Smith's work on understanding world religion. Sikhs, Jews, Muslims, Buddhists, Greek Orthodox, Protestant evangelicals, Protestant progressives, Protestant mainline. It'll be a great day in the Lord when all Protestants can get together. But his strategy was clear. If it was the extremist violence of one religion that gave force to the violence and destruction of 9/11/01, it would be the unity of many religions which would pray and work toward the day when we would say, "We are one." Francis could have gone to the memorial as just another tourist with a large security detail, but he went as a pilgrim. He went there to unite with other faiths in a witness against violence in the name of God. For such a time as then, he practiced the legacy of his name, where he was an instrument of God's peace. And I think this is significant. At the end of the service, Cardinal Dolan invited the guests to offer one another a sign of peace. The Pope departed from what is usual protocol for a Pope. Instead of remaining seated to receive the signs from others, he rose from his seat, embracing and touching the leaders from other faiths. Now, September 11th, 2001 was a dark day in Lower Manhattan. September 25, 2015 was an enlightened day, a day of hope, a day filled with the presence of God. For such a time as then, for such a time as now, God is calling us and claiming us for a life where we might use whatever gift we have to help redeem the world for such a time as this. How do you respond? Something about today's sermon draws me to Jane Kenyon's poetry, which is a poetry that is both starkly realistic but also quite optimistic. I love her poem Otherwise. I've used it before. Jane Kenyon dealt with deep depression, and she died from cancer, but managed to live with it. I love that poem. I got out of bed on two strong legs. It might have been otherwise. I ate cereal, sweet milk, a ripe, flawless peach. Might have been otherwise. I took the dog uphill to the birch wood. All morning I did the work I love. At noon I lay down with my mate. It might have been otherwise. We ate dinner together at a table with silver candlesticks. Might have been otherwise. I slept in a bed in a room with paintings on the walls and planned another day just like today. But one day I know it will be otherwise. Queen Esther is your and my sister, just as Jane Kenyon is, blessing the world with her blessings. Queen Esther is our sister, blessing the world with her beauty, her craft, her poise, her wonderful gifts of knowing when and how to speak. It could have been otherwise. I hear God calling you and me to bless the world for such a time as today, so it won't be otherwise. Amen. Friends, rise with me and let us say what we believe using the affirmation of faith. It's printed in your bulletin on what is the back page. Let us say together.